Increases in sea level rise may create a need to raise shorelines at existing developments, whether by dikes, floodwalls, or raised beaches. Raised shorelines are not a panacea. The dramatic failure of dike and floodwalls at New Orleans during Hurricane Katrina illustrates the consequences of a false sense of security. In British Columbia, several dike failures have led to a policy at the provincial level that encourages homes within a dike ring to be brought up to flood-proof levels. To design shorelines that will be resilient to sea level rise, we need to understand the basics of what drives coastal flooding. Storm surge is a key element, separate from sea level rise, created when large storms with low air pressure and high winds result in higher than normal water levels at a coast.
The power of storm surge is quite remarkable. This log was moved here by the wave action. We've also had storms that have moved these one-ton planter boxes out into the parking lot. Storm surge has also gone over the road, closing Highway 101 and flooding homes across the street where the residents had to be evacuated and rescued by the fire department using boats.
We often visit the waterfront in fair weather and during normal tides, but it's a different place during spring high tides. They happen several times a year. Add a storm, and the combination of storm surge and wind increases wave run-up on the beach. When we take the same storm conditions and steepen the shoreline with riprap, significant wave splash results. Wave overtopping risk is further increased by a vertical wall. We'll need to raise our shorelines to allow for sea level rise. In Trail Bay at the District of Seashelt, where wave overtopping has been a concern, the district has been weighing its options.
In looking at these solutions, a real concern we have with a seawall is the height it would have to be and the impact that a seawall would have on the adjacent properties. It may have to be as high as 2 meters from the current elevation that we're standing at, which would in effect block views of both the pedestrians along the esplanade here and from the adjacent properties such as the restaurant beside us and the homes further along.
The alternative is doing a green shores approach, which would be a soft structural report, which would end up being only about 18 inches higher than the existing grade.
Using sand and gravel to raise or construct a beach is often called beach nourishment and can be associated with green shores. It's a very common application in resort locations, often paid for by tourism revenues in places like Florida and the Gulf States. It works, but it requires careful engineering.
We built this shoreline 9 years ago. It was to protect an eroding shoreline, an eroding bluff that had cultural features in it. One of the things we wanted to do was try and maintain access to the beach, to maintain the beach, because obviously it's quite well used. And we wanted to provide something that would look relatively natural. So designing a constructed beach or a constructed shoreline requires you to understand what's happening out with the waves, what the water levels are, and the types of materials, the sizes of materials that you need to use. Here in this example, we have about a 1 inch minus gravelly sand material that is consistent with what was here before we actually put this structure in. And we used what was here before as our design analog. And that really is the best way to approach coming up with a size for this kind of material, is to go to a shoreline, take some samples, measure the sizes of material, and use that as a guide for the kinds of materials you need to use, because the material that you find on a shoreline will already have been exposed to the waves and water levels that occur at that side. Prospective design for one of these constructed beaches is how long you want it to last. It is a constructed feature that you need to maintain, so it has a design life. Typically you want to be looking at somewhere in the 10 to 20 years if possible. You can go for a shorter design life and place less material. You can go for a longer design life and place more material. You can go for a shorter design life and place finer material. You can go for a longer design life and place coarser material. Those are all aspects that can be considered when coming up with this sort of design.
The City of Vancouver installed beach nourishment in the late 1980s. Now, 30 years later, there are signs of erosion. Perhaps it's time to investigate beach nourishment again as a maintenance measure.
Design of any constructed shoreline, raised beach, dike, or floodwall requires site-specific information and analysis. Information is needed on the history of storms as well as the long-term records of winds, waves, and water levels that affect the site. We need to know the nearshore bathymetry, the depth of water, and shape of the offshore area. We also need detailed information on the shoreline topography, both before and after the proposed development or shoreline improvement. We must understand habitat issues and the potential to incorporate habitat into our solutions. As well as understanding historic tides and storm surge, we need to use an allowance for sea level rise for the life cycle of the development that includes consideration of relative uplift or subsidence of the land. Coastal engineers and geomorphologists use this information with a number of tools, such as computer models, to simulate the way shorelines interact with local wave conditions, currents, water levels, and sediment movements. With good quality data and accurate models, we can calculate the amount of wave run-up, splash and overtopping, or the beach erosion and accretion, and how these might increase with sea level rise. We can compare how several different shoreline alternatives will perform under different sea level rise scenarios to create adaptation pathways or maps that offer options for managing an uncertain future. This type of analysis is needed whether the option is a raised beach, a wetland habitat, a floodwall, a dike, or combinations of these.
On the land side of a dike, it's common to see drainage channels. They collect rainwater from inside the dike and bring it to pump stations or tidal gates where the water escapes to the sea during lower tides.
Behind the dikes and communities, there can be issues with rainfall, how to get rid of the water, with groundwater coming up higher. As the ocean levels go up higher, you will see your groundwater in the areas behind your dike coming up higher. With ground subsidence, if you have soft soils, you will see the houses and everything slowly sinking. All those have to be managed by the communities.
Flooding of New Orleans during Hurricane Katrina involved failure of a dike and flood wall due to poor foundation conditions. As dikes are upgraded, we need to stabilize the ground under them, allowing for both increased flood levels, the added mass of the dike, and the seismic risk of earthquake. Adding material to the dike for repair during a storm is a common practice. For this purpose, the crest of the dike includes maintenance access for inspection and service vehicles. The service road also acts as a popular recreation trail in many dikes, providing multiple public benefits. However, unless the trail is raised to compensate for sea level rise, the pedestrians on it will become increasingly at risk to wave overtopping during severe storms. All these factors, plus sea level rise, lead to a future height for the dike crest that's substantially higher than existing. The increased height has a dramatic impact on the dike footprint. Where should the dike expansion go? Push to the upland side, requiring private property acquisition and impacts on drainage, or to the ocean side, creating significant environmental impacts on habitat? A 2012 report predicted the range of cost at $9.4 billion for bringing existing flood protection infrastructure up to current standards in the BC Lower Mainland, including new dike heights to protect against sea level rise until the year 2100. As well as the structural and seismic costs, the report illustrates the urgency to reserve shoreline property now to provide space to adapt to future climate change. The costs are not just financial. Dikes are almost always fronting sensitive aquatic habitat. Without a dike, wetlands would move gradually upslope in response to sea level rise. With the hard line of a dike, coastal wetlands get squeezed between rising seas and fixed shorelines. To help shoreline wetlands adapt, can we move dikes back in some locations, or gradually trap sediment and raise the marshes in tandem with gradual sea level rise? Careful site-specific design is needed for all types of raised shorelines, dikes, floodwalls, or beach nourishment. Risk of failure and cost of maintenance can both be reduced by close attention to design calculations and the availability of good quality, site-specific, and long-term data. Design for raised shorelines is most effective and efficient at the scale of a waterfront bay or a neighborhood, with full integration of habitat and land use considerations. Raised dikes will be part of adapting to climate change, where existing dikes or high-value existing development offer no other feasible choice for protection against rising seas. However, governing agencies are likely to be very cautious of new dike installations in undeveloped floodplain areas due to the major sustained investment required to adapt to centuries of sea level rise.